You're watching City Showcase. My name is Bernard Avila. I'm talking to a very interesting thinker, Garrett Whitehill. He is a futurist in residence in Africa. So much passion for the continent. It's amazing. He says the West African sub-region has a lot of promise and we should believe. He also says there are some great demographic changes which are both challenges but opportunities that we should focus on. We'll explore those ideas in this next part of the interview. Let's talk about Ghana.
Sure.
You say Ghana is the trigger that will bring the African Revolution.
Absolutely.
And being Ghanaian, I'm happy to hear that. But I'm wondering where the growth is going to come from, because analyzing our economy, we're still very resource driven. So we export cocoa. And although we process a lot of it here, over 70% is still exported raw.
Right.
We export gold, and it's predominantly unprocessed gold. Now we have oil, and we're not refining the oil here before export. We export crude.
That's right.
And then we buy finished products. So my view is we are a resource-dependent economy. How are you going to transform to become the trigger to growth if you don't change that structure of economy?
It's a great question. So the first thing is, Bernard, we need to take a step back, and we need to talk about politics, right? Somehow, in the infinite genius of here in Ghana, over the past 60 years, so from 1957 till now, somehow, the structure here in the country has been you make money in the political sphere instead of the business sphere. And so what you have is you have politicians who are indifferent in a lot of ways to the business environment and the changes that need to happen here, right? You actually have politicians, to be frank with you, who use education, infrastructure, and food as weapons, right? If you vote, we'll give you roads. If you vote, we'll give you electricity on borrowed time. If you vote, we'll give you food, right? Right? So what you have is you have the money being made in the wrong place in the first place. That's the first place we have to start and have a very direct and honest and humble conversation around. Once we have that conversation and we figure out how to bring more money and value and connections into business, what we need to focus on, to your point, is value add business, right? Why aren't we refining the crude here? Why aren't we doing value add services here? There's no reason this country can't. Right? Ghanaians have one of the best penetration rates in terms of technology and mobile, right? Particularly on this side of Africa. And so the opportunity is there, but the policies aren't in place and the incentives aren't there, right?
So policy and incentives to take advantage. But what role innovation play in all of this? How do we become a future ready? Because the world is moving so fast now.
That's right.
And technology seems to be the driver. What are your thoughts about how Ghana can harness technology and innovation to actually be competitive in the future of the world?
Well, the first thing is to understand what future ready means, right? What you see a lot of politicians doing these days is looking in the past and trying to catch up to the past instead of already looking at the future, right? And so what we have is politicians who are looking at trying to make Ghana past compatible. They're looking at what solutions help past infrastructure, 20th century ideas, 20th century thinking, Western models. They're not looking at what is Ghana need over the next 10, 20 years as it has a population that is 18 to 59, one of the largest and growing populations on the continent, right? So that's the first thing we need to be looking at. They're not looking forward, they're looking backward. They're still looking at Western standards, things that come from the UN or the World Economic Forum, and all these places that are still based on industrial infrastructure, 20th century ideas, and frankly, colonial thinking. We don't need any more of that. What we need is solutions by Africans, for Africans, in
Africa.
So
ditch the IMF, ditch the World Bank.
Absolutely.
This is the World Economic
Absolutely.
Forum. Come up with a new economic paradigm.
Absolutely.
What's your proposal for jobs? It's interesting that you see demography as an opportunity in
right.
saying that the future is Africa.
Right.
Because some people look at demography and they are scared. The average age of a Ghanaian is 20.4 years.
That's right.
I'm told that 400,000 people enter our labor market every year. Youth unemployment is in the 50s.
Correct.
That's scary.
Correct.
Especially if your economic structure remains the same. How do you reckon we're going to create jobs for all these people?
Well, one of the great things that's being done here in Accra and is a testament to what politicians are trying to do, right, in coordination with business, is something like Silicon Accra, right, which is its own 60-acre self-sustaining community. It's not just an accelerator. It's not just an incubator. It's not just housing. It's everything you could need on a 60-acre plot of land, right? That's a self-reciprocating opportunity for places where people can live, work, and play in an environment that is coordinated, that allows for these collisions to happen. What you hear a lot of times, for instance, about innovation with Silicon Valley is Silicon Valley is just a mindset. And that's true. But the other point of it is the way Silicon Valley is structured from an infrastructure perspective, from an innovation perspective, from a connective perspective, is collisions happen. People meet each other just by the nature of being walking down the same street, right? Sitting in the same cafes. Right now, what we have is all of our millennial generation still out in Teshi, up in Kumasi, still spread.
They're not connected.
They're not connected. You have folks like Ato from the Think Ghana Foundation who's trying to make those connections. What we need is better infrastructure and better tools. Some of that is going to come through hard infrastructure, right, through Silicon Accra, and some of it's going to come through digital infrastructure. There are great things that technology with the right values can bring
but
to
who's
Ghana.
Going to initiate this coming together? Is it government or business? Because clearly you're saying we need to connect the dots.
That's right.
Is this a government function or private sector function?
It's both. It's collaborative, and it also needs a very keen eye from the media too, right? This idea that we can continue to have an isolationist idea where it's me first, right, versus us first, that's not going to work here. Right? If you look at Ghana, the reason I love this country, the reason this country has such opportunity is because it's strength and bonds. You and I are 2 degrees away from anybody in this country, literally. That is something that is miraculous. That's not true anywhere else in the world, and we can accelerate that through technology. But we have to come together to the table to challenge ourselves to do things the opposite of how we have been doing it. And that's what it comes down to, right? If you want to be adaptive and resilient in the 21st century, if you want to be future ready, you have to have the courage to have the hard conversations and do the right things at the right time. It's not easy to say goodbye to the UN, to some of these policies that take all of our exports. It's not easy to do that, but these are the things we need to do in the short term to build capacity.
What are your predictions for Africa generally? You've made part of that prediction, but for Ghana specifically,
sure.
If you look in a crystal ball, in a quarter of a century, what do you see?
Well, I'm going to start with Africa first, right, from a big lens, right? In the next 10 to 15 years, what you're going to see needs to happen in all of Africa is you need 30 to 40 years of progress within the next 10 years. That's an acceleration phase like this. And when you have outdated thinking and structures and some of the things we've been talking about, hit the millennial generation who's full of change, who does want to question things, who do have critical thinking capacity, and who want what the politicians to say to actually implement, what you're going to see is some pretty heavy friction in the short term. That friction is not something we should shy away from. That's something we should invite. Because friction, that moment of chaos also breeds creativity. We have to remember, unstable times create the best opportunities, right? That's why the West actually has more opportunity. Right, than anywhere else. We didn't follow the Western values. We went our own way. And in the short term, it was a lot harder for Ghana and in the West. But over the next 100 years, we're going to see the change happen here. So that's number one. Right? In the short term, it's going to be pretty rough. But we're going to see that tsunami of chaos even out into ripples. There's still always going to be issues here in Africa, but that's what makes Africa special. Chaos by design. Right? Number two, what you're going to see is the Western region of Africa, take a majority role in deciding policy across the continent. You know, if ECOWAS can come together and stop just focusing on economics, but focus on Africa and the Africans in general, and start talking about integrated economics and integrated policy, right? How we can stand up and come together as a community for Africans, by Africans. This region is who will lead the change. Once again, 29 million people can directly affect 1.2 billion people. When it comes to Ghana in particular, what we need is we need politicians who actually have courage, right? Right now, we're in an election cycle, right? We have one politician who we know just takes, right? And the other choice is a politician who takes two, but people are open to listening to him because they think maybe he'll share a little with people. That idea of you can just take and maybe give a little, this trickle-down effect that keeps going on here in Ghana, has to stop, and it has to stop now. And if it doesn't stop, guess what? The millennial generation will make it stop.
You feel if the orthodoxy doesn't change, people will force it to change. If the way politicians see the citizens doesn't change, there's going to be some sort of upheaval.
It's inevitable. You cannot fight demographics. The millennial generation lives, works, and plays for doing better for more people.
When you say millennial generation, I know these are very Americocentric. You need to break that down a bit.
Sure.
So because you talk of baby boomers, this was after the World War,
sure.
1940. So when you say millennials, you're talking about people who were born post 1990? Is that what you're referring
to? You're talking to anybody below 35 years of age today.
Okay, so that's, yeah. So
that's where the change is coming
from. From 1980 upwards.
Absolutely.
I see. But what's your role? Again, let's come back to you to end this.
Sure.
So you are, I know you're a thinker, you're a strategist, and you are very passionate about innovation. I get the sense you're on some sort of crusade to get people to do things different. Tell me a bit about what you are doing. Clearly, you've seen Africa as the opportunity. You've almost moved here entirely.
Right.
What's your role in this all of this? What are you trying to do?
I believe that humans deserve better, Bernard. And when I travel across this continent, what I hear over and over is people who just want an opportunity to do three things. Be happy, healthy, have an ability to take care of their family. Right? That's all they're asking for in reality. That's not too much to ask. And when I leave this continent and I watch the news or I hear people talk about this continent, you know, there's a reason that in America, for instance, all the cable networks are only owned by corporations, five corporations. And those corporations happen to be the corporations that come here and take the gold and take the oil and take all these things. And it's just so interesting that they come here, take all the resources out, don't help our local communities, but then all they talk about is, you know, about AIDS, about wars, and about Ebola in Africa. That's all you hear. People are afraid of Africa, right? It's not because Americans aren't humane. It's not because Europeans are stupid. It's because they're blind. They still trust their media. They don't realize that the media is completely upending what's actually going on in the opportunity on this continent. And that's why I'm here, to change the narrative, to not just help people on the ground, right? So help businesses become future ready, help mayors and governors and presidents of countries understand how to build better cities, better countries that are ready for the impending growth. And not just to help the media play a more key role in bringing accountability and transparency, but also the rest of the world understanding what the opportunity is here and what's really going on the ground. You know, let me give you a quick example. Every day I publish a picture on Instagram just of something as I'm going by that's interesting about Africa, right? Every day I do a hashtag #EverydayAfrica. You'd be amazed the feedback I get on all my social networks from my friends who've never been outside of America. They can't believe this is what Africa is actually like. People shaking hands, right? Nice bodegas where it says the happy meat, right? Selling meat. All these things that you don't hear these positive stories, you only ever hear the negative. What I'm here to do is help this continent become the continent that was ripped away from itself by the colonial powers. For the past couple hundred years, Africa has lost its resources, its independence, and its humanity. And now it's coming back. And I am heck bent on helping make sure that happens.
You are the great liberator, the conquistador.
I'm just trying to help humans. Because humans deserve better, my friend.
I'm just kidding. So Gary Whitehill has made some very interesting points. He describes himself as a futurist in residence in Africa, traveled to 15 countries regularly, and very interesting. He says Southern Africa and Northern Africa are in crisis, East Africa is in decline or devolution, and West Africa is where the future is. And in fact, Ghana is the black star of Africa. We'll explore these ideas a bit further in subsequent interviews. But thank you for watching this edition of City Showcase. My name is Bernard Avelet. Keep watching City TV.